وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد وإن شرح في كتاب الشمائل المحمدية written by الإمام أبو عيسى الترمذي رحمه الله We've taken the first two hadiths and inshallah ta'ala we're now going to go into the third hadith بإذن الله الكريم قال المصنف رحمه الله الحديث الثالث قال المصنف رحمه الله تعالى الحديث الثالث حدثنا محمد بن بشار قال حدثنا محمد بن جعفر قال حدثنا شعبة عن أبي إسحاق قال سمعت البراء بن عازب يقول كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رجلا كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رجلا مربوعا بعيد ما بين المنكبين عظيم الجمة إلى شحمة أذنيه عليه حلة حمراء ما رأيت شيئا قط أحسن منه إن شاء الله تعالى We're now going to go into the third hadith بإذن الله الكريم And إن شاء الله تعالى We're going to take from this hadith 11 benefits بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ الْكَرِيمِ The first inshallah ta'ala benefit that we're going to take is حَدَّثَنَا مُحَمَّدُ بْنُ بَشَّارٍ Some of the copies of this hadith in the chain it says حَدَّثَنَا مُحَمَّدُ بْنُ بَشَّارٍ الْعَبْدِي which is his name الْعَبْدِي Or it says, يعني العبدي. It says, يعني العبدي in some of the copies that I saw. In some of the copies that I saw, it says, يعني العبدي بصيغة الغائب. يعني العبدي is in a بصيغة الغائب. In Arabic grammar, it's this form is like It's talking about someone who's absent. There's a possibility now that the one who's saying this is the Musannif himself. يعني الإمام الحافظ الترمذي رحمه الله. So why would he say حدثنا محمد بن بشار and then after that say يعني العبدي. He should have said أعني, I mean, instead of saying يعني, why would he change the form into al-ghaib. Some scholars, they mention it could possibly be ala tariqat al-iltifat. And this is one of the usloob min asalib al-arab that they do, that they change the form like that from the angle of al-iltifat, which is apparent, it could be. And it could also be possible, which is a second possibility, an yakuna min kalami ba'di talamidatihi. It could be possible that one of his students is the one who brought that part into the word, into the chain, يعني العبدي, to not confuse him with any other Muhammad ibn Bashar. It could be possible. على كل حال, his name is Bundar Muhammad ibn Bashar ibn Uthman ibn Dawood ibn Kaysan. His name is Bundar Muhammad ibn Bashar ibn Uthman ibn Dawood ibn Kaysan. And the word al-bundar, it means al-hafidh. Because he memorized a lot of hadith. ولذلك الإمام الذهبي, he said, الإمام الحافظ راوية الإسلامي أبو بكر العبدي البصري بندار لقب بذلك لأنه كان بندار الحديث في عصره ببلده والبندار الحافظ. So al-bundar means hafidh. And الإمام الذهبي praised him by calling him al-imam. Al-Hafidh, and we already took what Hafidh is. Hafidh is a person who at least memorized 100,000 ahadiths with its chains and with its chain and with the wording of the hadith. Rawiyatul Islam, the narrator of al-Islam. And then he mentioned he was called Bundar, Bundar, because he was a hafiz. He reached a high level. Al-Imam ibn Khuzayma, Abu Bakr ibn Khuzayma, Imam al-A'imma, in Kitab al-Tawheed, he said, أَخْبَرَنَا إِمَامُ أَهْلِ زَمَانِهِ فِي الْعِلْمِ وَالْأَخْبَارِ مُحَمَّدِ ibn Basharin. Imam al-A'imma ibn Khuzayma, in Kitab al-Tawheed, when he narrated from Muhammad ibn Basharin, he said, أَخْبَرَنَا إِمَامُ أَهْلِ زَمَانِهِ, the Imam of his time, in ilm, and also in narration and transmission, Muhammad ibn Basharin. So that's a praise for him. He was born when the year was سَنَةَ سَبْعٍ وَسِتِينَ وَمِئَةٍ, 164 Hijriah, he was born. He narrated from Yazid ibn Zuray', Mu'tamir ibn Sulayman, Marhum ibn Abdul Aziz al-Attar, Abdul Aziz ibn Abdul Samad al-Ammi, wa Ghundar, wa Yahya ibn Sa'id, wa Abdul Wahhab al-Thaqafi, wa Umar ibn Ali, wa Tafawi, wa Bahz ibn Asad, wa Abdul Rahman ibn Mahdi, ومعاذ بن معاذ ومعاذ بن هشام ويزيد بن هارون ووكيع بن الجراح وخلق سواهم. الإمام الذهبي mentioned something very beneficial, worthy of mentioning here. In Sir Alam al-Nubala, he said, وجمع حديث البصرة, he gathered the hadith of the people of Basra. ولم يرحل برا بأمه, but he never traveled. He never traveled because he was obeying his mother. She didn't want him to travel. ثم رحل بعدها, he traveled after that. قال عبد الله بن جعفر بن خاقان المروزي, he said, سمعت بندارا يقول, the Hadith transmitting this, that عبد الله بن جعفر بن خاقان, he said, المروزي, I heard بندار saying, أردت الخروج, I wanted to leave, يعني الرحلة, I wanted to travel to narrate hadiths, فمنعتني أمي, my mother said, you're not going to travel. فأطعتها, I obeyed my mother. فبورك لي فيه, and Allah placed barakah in it for me. His mother said, you're not going to leave. He said, okay, I won't leave. I'll stay. And when she passed away, he traveled after that. Many scholars took from him. The six imams of hadith, they all narrated from him. Bukhari, Muslim, Abi Dawud, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Nasa'i. Abu Zur'at al-Razi narrated from him. Abu Hatim al-Razi narrated from him. Ibrahim al-Harbi narrated from him. Baqiyya ibn Makhlad narrated from him. Abdullah ibn Ahmad narrated from him. Abu al-Abbas al-Sarraj narrated from him. Ibn Khuzayma narrated from him. And Zakariya al-Saji narrated from him. He died, as Imam al-Bukhari you mentioned, and other great scholars have mentioned as well, he died in the month of Rajab, when the year was سنت اثنتين وخمسين ومئتين, 252 Hijriah. The second, inshallah ta'ala, point that we want to take from the hadith, the second benefit, is the second narrator in the hadith. قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا مُحَمَّدُ بْنُ جَعْفَرٍ, who is Muhammad ibn Ja'far. Who is Muhammad ibn Ja'far? He is Ghundar Muhammad ibn Ja'far, Abu Abdullah al-Hudaliyu. Al-Imam al-Dhahabiyu, he said about him, البصري الكرابيسي تاج أحد المتقنين. He said he's one of the solidified, يعني متقن, he mastered the science of hadith. He was born سنة بضع عشرة ومئة. He was born 111, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, around that time. وروى عن, he narrated from حسين بن معلم وعبد الله بن سعيد بن أبي هند وعوف الأعرابي وابن جريج وجعفر بن ميمون الأنباطي ومعمر بن راشد وسعيد بن أبي عروبة. And ذهبي said, وشعبة, he also narrated from شعبة, فأكثر عنه وجود وحرر. And I like this point for us to take on board. غندر narrated from who? He narrated from many people, but from the people he mastered their narrations. He solidified his understanding of their narration is Shu'bah ibn Hajjaj Abu Bistam al-Ataki. We're going to take him soon, inshallah ta'ala. He took from him. He said, وَشُعْبَةَ فَأَكْثَرَ عَنُهُ. He took a lot from Shu'bah. وَجَوَّدَ وَحَرَّرَ. He mastered it. And he, يعني, sift through it. Many people took from Ghundar. Ali ibn al-Madini took from him. Ahmed ibn Hanbal took from him. Yahya ibn Ma'in took from him. Ishaq ibn Rahuya took from him. Abu Bakr ibn Abi Shayba took from him. Amr ibn Ali took from him. And Muhammad ibn Bashar, al-Bundar, who we already mentioned. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi mentioned, he said, قُلْتُ, يعني Dhabi saying, مَا أَظُنُّ رَحَلَ فِي الْحَدِيثِ مِنَ الْبَصْرَةِ. I don't think he traveled في الحديث from Basra. وَابْنُ جُرَيْجٍ هُوَ الَّذِينَ سَمَّاهُ غُنْدَرًا. And the person who called him this Ghundar was Ibn Jurayj. And the reason for this was that he kept asking Ibn Jurayj so many questions. He was asking and asking him too much. And then he said to him, you are ma anta illa Ghundarun. You are Ghundar. You are Ghundar. And Imam al-Dhahabi, he also said, اتفق أرباب الصحاح على احتجاج بغندر. Bukhari and Muslim have unanimously agreed upon using the narrations of Ghundar. He died in Dhil Qa'dah. He died سنة 93 ومئة رحمه الله, when the year was 193 Hijriya. The third, inshallah ta'ala, point that we want to take is the third narrator. He is Shu'bah. قال حدثنا شعبة عن أبي إسحاق. His name is شعبة بن الحجاج بن الورد أبو بسطام الأزدي العتكي. الإمام الذهبي, he said about him, الإمام الحافظ أمير المؤمنين في الحديث. And it said that he was the first person to be given that title of أمير المؤمنين في الحديث. الإمام الذهبي, he said, وكان من أوعية العلم. He was an ocean of knowledge. لا يتقدم أحد في الحديث في زماني. At his time, شعبة بن الحجاج أبو بسطام العتكي, at his time, no one could speak about hadith at his time. He was the imam of it. وهو من نظراء الأوزاعي ومعمر والثوري في الكثرة. And he was, these were his peers and the people he was like. الإمام الأوزاعي وإمام أهل الشام, معمر بن راشد إمام أهل اليمن, سفيان الثوري. He was like these people. ولذلك علي بن المديني, he said, له نحو من ألفي حديث. He has 2,000 أحاديث. الإمام الذهبي, he said, قلت ما أظن إلا يروي أكثر من ذلك بكثير. الإمام الذهبي commented on the statement of علي بن المديني, and then he said, مَا أَظُنُّ, I don't think, except that he narrates more than that. His narrations are even more than what Ali ibn al-Madini is saying. He was born, Shu'bah ibn al-Hajjaj, Abu Bistam al-Ataki, was born سَنَةَ ثَمَانِينَ. He was born فِي دَوْلَةِ عَبْدِ الْمَلِكِ ibn Marwan. وَحَدَّثَ عَنْ, he took from Anas ibn Sirin, was a brother of Muhammad ibn Sirin. He also took from Ismail ibn al-Raja, Salamat ibn Kuhail, Wajami' ibn al-Shaddad, Sa'id ibn Abi Sa'id al-Maqburi, Wajabalat ibn Suhaym, Wal-Hakam ibn Utaybata, Wa'amr ibn Murrah, Wazubayd ibn al-Harith al-Yami, Waqatadat ibn Da'amat al-Sadusi, Wamu'awiyat ibn Qurrah, Wa'abi Jamrat al-Duba'i, وعمر بن دينار ويحيى بن أبي كثير وعبيد بن الحسن وعدي بن ثابت وطلحة بن مصرف والمنهال بن عمرو سعيد بن أبي بردة وسماك بن الوليد وأيوب السختياني ومنصور بن المعتمر وخلق كثير سواهم. He narrated from many other people other than that. الإمام الذهبي, he said, ذكر الشيخنا أبو الحجاج في تهذيبه. الإمام الذهبي, he said, my teacher, يعني أبو الحجاج المزي, in his تهذيب الكمال, He mentioned لِشُعْبَةَ ثَلَاثُ مِئَةِ شَيْخٍ سَمَّاهُمْ. He has 300 teachers that he took from. We only mentioned some. How many? 300. And Abu al-Hajjaj al-Mizzi mentioned each and every one of them in his tahdhib. The people that took from him are too many, brothers and sisters. The Abi mentions, he said, رَوَى عَنْهُ عَالَمٌ عَظِيمٌ. A whole world of people narrated from him. وَانْتَشَرَ حَدِيثَهُ فِي الْآفَاقِ. His hadith, they traveled the world. The people that narrated from him are many. From them is Ayyub al-Sakhtiyani and Mansur ibn al-Mu'tamir and Aban ibn Taghlib. Aban ibn Taghlib. وسفيان الثوري وزائدة بن قدامة وزهير بن معاوية وعلي بن حمزة الكسائي وعبد السلام بن حرب وإسماعيل بن علي وعبد الله بن مبارك وعباد بن عباد ومحمد بن جعفر بن غندر وأبو اسحاق الفزاري وبشر بن السري وبقية بن الوليد وحمادان يعني حماد بن زيد وحماد بن سلمة سفيان بن عيينة شريك القاضي عبد الله بن إدريس يحيى بن سعيد القطان عبد الرحمن بن مهدي أبو عبيدة معمر بن المثنى وكيع بن جراح الرؤاسي هشيم نضر بن الشميل هارون الرشيد يحيى بن أبي زائدة يزيد بن هارون يونس بن بكير القاضي أبو يوسف يعقوب الحضرمي أبو داود الطيالسي محمد بن أبي عدي آدم بن أبي إياس أمية بن خالد محمد بن عرعرة أسود بن عامر أسد بن موسى عفان بن مسلم الصفاح أبو جابر محمد بن عبد الملك أبو عامر عبد الملك القعدي محمد بن كثير العبدي سليمان بن حرب عبد الله بن مسلمة القعنبي موسى بن إسماعيل التبوذكي and many other people narrated from him. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi rahimahullah, he mentioned, he said in his Sir Alam al-Nubala, he said, وحدثني عبد الله بن أحمد بن شبوية. He said, سمعت أبا الوليد سمعت شعبة يقول. شعبة said, إذا كان عندي دقيق وقصب. If I have bread, يعني الدقيق أن قصب يعني قصب sugar cane. ما أبالي ما فاتني من الدنيا. I don't care whatever I lose from the dunya. As long as I get those two, inshallah ta'ala. That's the type of person he was. Abu Bahr al-Bakrawi, he mentions, he says, ما رأيت أحدا أعبد من شعبة. I have never seen anyone who worshipped Allah more than شعبة. لقد عبد الله حتى جف جلده على عظمه وسودا. He worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so much. Shu'bah ibn Hajjaj, Shu'bah rahimahullah, he worshipped Allah so much so until his skin became hard on his bones and he became black, darkened. The type of worshipper he was. Point number four, inshallah ta'ala, is Abu Ishaq al-Sabi'i, who's in the narration. He's the fourth narrator. قال حدثنا شعبة عن أبي إسحاق أبو إسحاق السبيعي عن أبي إسحاق. Who's this أبي إسحاق that took from al-Baraa ibn Aazib, the companion? He is أبو إسحاق السبيعي. أبو إسحاق السبيعي. عمرو بن عبد الله الهمداني الكوفي. His name is disputed from that. الإمام الذهبي said الحافظ شيخ الكوفة وعالمها ومحدثها. He's the hafidh and the sheikh of the people of Kufa. وكان رحمه الله من العلماء العاملين, Dhabi says. He said he's from the scholars who acted upon his knowledge. ومن جلة التابعين, he's from the honorable تابعين. وهو ثقة حجة بلا نزاع. He said he's a reliable person. He's a proof without a dispute. He also said, وقد كبر وتغير حفظه تغير السن ولم يختلط. And this point I think is very important. He said he has grown in age and he became old and his hifd slightly changed due to age. وَلَمْ يَخْتَلِطْ وَلَمْ يَخْتَلِطْ. Very important. There's a mistake that many people believe Abu Ishaq al-Sabi'i mixed up. That's not correct. He became old in age and he became يعني, old and he started to forget things like he didn't mix up. He said about himself, وُلِدْتُ لِسَنَتَيْنِ بَقِيَتَا مِنْ خِلَافَةِ عُثْمَانِ. He said, I was born 2 years remaining from the Khilafah of Uthman. Yani 2 years before Uthman died. وَرَأَيْتُ I saw, he said, عَلِيَ بْنَ أَبِي طَالِبٍ يَخْطُبُ. I saw Ali ibn Abi Talibin giving khutbah. He saw who? He saw Ali ibn Abi Talibin giving khutbah. Okay? And Abu Ishaq al-Sabi'i is one of the most knowledgeable people when it comes to the hadith of Ali ibn Abi Talib and the hadith of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. He's one of the most knowledgeable people. Very important that we understand that, inshallah ta'ala. And his knowledge of the hadith of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and Ali ibn Abi Talib is very high. Now that we've understood that, let's mention, inshallah ta'ala, who did he narrate from? He narrated from Mu'awiyah ibn Abi Sufyan and Adi ibn Hatim and Abdullah ibn Abbas and al-Baraa ibn Aazib and Zayd ibn Arqam and Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As and Abi Juhayfah al-Suwa'i and Sulaiman ibn Suradin and Umarah ibn Ruwaybah al-Thaqafi and Abdullah ibn Yazid al-Ansari and Amr ibn al-Harith al-Khuza'i and other than them from the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he read the Qur'an on who? Al-Aswad ibn Yazid and also on Abi Abdul Rahman al-Sulami, Abdullah ibn Habib. He read the Qur'an on him. Abu al-Ahwas, he said, قَالَ لَنَا أَبُو إِسْحَاقَ السَّبِيعِ. Abu Ishaq al-Sabi'i said to him one day, يَا مَعْشَرَ الشَّبَابِ, youngsters, youths, اغْتَنِمُوا قُوَّتَكُمْ وَشَبَابَكُمْ. Benefit, youths and youngsters, from your strength and from the age that Allah has given you. قَلَّمَا مَرَّتْ بِي لَيْلَةٌ. He said, little does a night go by إِلَّا وَأَنَا أَقْرَأُ فِيهَا أَلْفَ آيَةٍ, except that I recite 1,000 verses. وَإِنِّي لَأَقْرَأُ الْبَقَرَةَ فِي كُلِّ رَكْعَةٍ. I read Baqarah in one rak'ah, in every rak'ah. وَإِنِّي لَأَصُومُ, and I fast الْأَشْهُرَ الْحُرُمَ, I fast the 4 sacred months. وَثَلَاثَةَ أَيَّامٍ مِّن كُلِّ شَهْرٍ, and I fast 3 days in every month. وَالْإِثْنَيْنَ وَالْخَمِيسَ, and I fast on Mondays and Thursdays. Al-Akhnasiyyu mentioned, he said, حَدَّثَنَا الْعَلَىٰ إِبْنُ سَالِمٍ الْعَبْدِيُّ قَالَ ضَعُفَ أَبُو إِسْحَاقَ السَّبِيعِ. Abu Ishaq al-Sabi'i became very weak. قَبْلَ مَوْتِي بِسَنَتَيْنِ, 2 years before his death, he became very weak. فَمَا كَانَ يَقْدِرُ أَن يَقُومَ, so he wasn't able to stand up. حَتَّى يُقَامَ, until someone will come and stand him up. فَإِذَا اسْتَتَمَّ قَائِمًا, whenever he would be stood up, and somebody would help him, grab him. Once he stood up and he had his balance and he stood up, he would recite 1,000 lines from the Qur'an. 1,000 ayah, sorry. He would recite, قَرَأَ وَهُوَ قَائِمٌ أَلْفَ آيَةٍ. He would recite 1,000 ayah. Allahu Akbar. There's another point, inshallah ta'ala, that I think, inshallah ta'ala, is very important that I mention it, which is, if two people narrate from Abu Ishaq al-Sabi'i, their narration of Abu Ishaq al-Sabi'i is accepted. Because remember what I mentioned, he became very old in age. He started to get mistakes. He started to forget many narrations. He started to forget. He didn't mix up. He didn't, ikhtilat never happened to him. That's a mistaken belief. That's a mistaken belief. Like what happened is because he became very old, he became weak, and so he started to forget hadiths. Like any human being would. Like ikhtilat never happened to him. Okay? Just forgetting hadiths here or there. So, his hadiths were strongest and the best when Shu'bah narrated from him. That was before he started to forget hadiths. And Sufyan al-Thawri. If Sufyan al-Thawri and Shu'bah narrate from Abu Ishaq al-Sabi'i, accept it. Don't worry about it. لكن if Sufyan ibn Uyayna narrates from him, then it's a problem. It's a problem. It's after he started to forget and after he became, he went into that state of forgetting ahadiths. Ahmad ibn Abdata, he said, I heard Abu Dawood al-Tayalisi saying, وجدنا الحديث عند أربعة. We found the hadiths present with four people. الزهري وقتادة وأبو إسحاق والأعمش. Four people. محمد بن شهاب الزهري, قتادة بن دعامة السدوسي, and أبو إسحاق السبيعي, and سليمان بن مهران الأعمش. These four. وكان قتادة أعلمهم بالاختلاف. قتادة knew the اختلاف more than them, and اختلاف الحديث. والزهري أعلمهم بالإسناد, and محمد بن شهاب الزهري was the most knowledgeable one when it came to the chain. وأبو إسحاق السبيعي أعلمهم بحديث علي وابن مسعود, and the one who knew the most when it comes to hadith of علي بن أبي طالب and Abdullah ibn Mas'ud is أبو إسحاق السبيعي. وكان عند الأعمش من كل هذا, and سليمان بن مهران الأعمش had all of those. He had what Zuhri had, he had what Qatada had, he also had what أبو إسحاق السبيعي had. ولم يكن عند واحد من هؤلاء إلا ألفين. And these scholars, they had thousands of narrations. The fifth, inshallah ta'ala, is the Sahabi al-Baraa ibn Aazib. قال سمعت البراأ ابن عازب يقول. This hadith is narrated from the companion al-Baraa ibn Aazib ibn al-Harithi, Abu Umara al-Ansari al-Harithi, نزيل الكوفة. His companion al-Baraa ibn Aazib, he resided in Kufa. And it means he's from the A'yan al-Sahaba, one of the great noble companions. He participated in the battles of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the battle of Badr, he was turned back because of being very young. وَاسْتُصْغِرَ يَوْمَ بَدْرٍ. He and Abdullah ibn Umar, both of them were turned away the battle of Badr. They were very young in age. Bukhari narrated from him 15 hadithan, 15 hadiths. And Al-Imam Muslim narrated from him bisittatin, only 6 hadiths. He died, Al-Baraa ibn Aazib, sanatathnatayni wa sab'ina, 72 Hijriya. The sixth, inshallah ta'ala, benefit that I want to mention from the hadith is rajulan. كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رجلا. كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رجلا. That's the sixth benefit that we want to take from the hadith, inshallah ta'ala. What does رجلا mean? The word رجلا, there's two ways of saying it. The first one is بفتح الراء. You say راء وكسر الجيم. So you say ra jilan. If you say rajilan, it means bayna al-ju'udati wal-subutati. It's the hair of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was between it being straight and curly. And his hair was not too straight and not too curly, it was in the middle. That's what Abdul Malik ibn Quraib al-Asma'i mentioned. That if we say بفتح الراء وكسر الجيم, we say رجل. لكن if we read it as بضم الجيم, and it happened and it occurred in some of the riwayat المعتمدة, which is رجلا, then this means, of course, المعنى المتبادر المتعارف, the meaning that's well known, which is الذي يراد به لفظ الرجل وهو المقابل للمرأة. يعني he was a man صلى الله عليه وسلم, which is the opposite of a female. So those are the two ways you can say it. كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رجلا مربوعا. When the صحابي mentioned البراء بن عازب رضي الله تعالى عنه, he said مربوعا. And the word marboo'an, we've already taken it in the second hadith and we took it in the first hadith. It's the same as the hadith of Anas ibn Malik where he said, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رَبْعَةً, in the previous hadith that we took. وَالرَّبْعَةَ وَالْمَرْبُوعُ. What does that mean? It means مُتَوَسِّطُ الْقِيَامَةِ. When he stands, he's in the middle, صلى الله عليه وسلم. He's in too tall It isn't too short. Salawatullah wa salamun alayhi. Wasat. Okay? Lakin, all of this, by the way, is ala wajhi taqrib. And it's just to get the matter closed. وإلا فهناك نصوص دلت على أنه صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى الطول أقرب منه إلى القصر. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was more closer to being taller than to be shorter صلى الله عليه وسلم. The eighth point, inshallah ta'ala, that we want to take from the hadith of al-Baraa ibn Aazib is بعيد ما بين المنكبين. بعيد ما بين المنكبين. There's two ways of reading it. There's two ways in which it came. It came مكبرة and مصغرة. You can say بعيدة or you can say بعيدة. And البعيد means ضد القريب. It's the opposite of what? It's the opposite of close. It's a kinaya of an si'at al-sadr. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, his chest was vast. يعني. That's what it is. Alayhi sallallahu alayhi. His shoulders was not in. He's spread out. Alayhi sallallahu alayhi. So you can say ba'ida or you can say bu'ayda. Just like the word ghulam and ghulaym. بلكن أصل في اللغة. When you look at the original, يعني in the Arabic language, when you're making it مصغر, you should say بعيد بتشديد الياء, like you say عليم. That's the أصل في تصغيرهما. You don't say عليم or بعيد. You say بعيد غليم. That's how you say it. So بعيد المنكبين. What does منكب mean? حافظ بن حجر العسقلاني, he said المنكب مجمع عظم العضد والكتف ومعناه عريض أعلى الظهر. It means the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, the منكب is the shoulder. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, his shoulders were spread out. صلوات الله وسلام عليه. And this is beauty. It was beauty. Point number 9 that we want to take from the hadith, inshallah ta'ala, of Al-Bara ibn Aazib is عظيم الجمة إلى شحمة أذنيه. عظيم الجمة إلى شحمة أذنيه. This is what we want to take from the hadith. And the way we say it is بضم الجيم وتشديد الميم. You say جمة. And it means كثيفها. By the way, the sha'ar, when it comes to length, it comes in three descriptions. يعني the hair, يعني the length of the hair, according to the Arabs, there are three descriptions. And the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he falls under all three categories. His hair were like that, صلى الله عليه وسلم. The first one is called al-jummah. The second one is called al-wafra. And the third one is called al-limma. And I've seen it also said as lumma, both ways. All of those wasf were the hair of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. Let's go into what Sahib al-Nihaya mentioned. Ibn Athir, al-Nihaya fi Ghareeb al-Hadith. The word al-jumma. What is the word al-jumma? And al-wafra. And the word al-limma ama al-lumma. What is it? الوفرة الشعر, it means إلى شحمة الأذن. It means الوفرة, it means when the hair reaches the earlobe. The word شحمتي الأذن means هو الجزء اللين المتدلي من الأذن الذي يوضع فيه القطر بالنسبة للمرأة. It's the place where you put the earrings. That's what شحمتي الأذن means. So when you hear الوفرة, it means when the hair reaches the earlobe. The Prophet's hair sometimes was like that. What does al-lummah mean? Okay? Al-lummah, it means ما جاوز الشحمة الأذن سواء وصل إلى المنكبين أو لا. It's when the hair goes beyond the earlobe. Whether it reaches the shoulders or not, it doesn't matter. It's called al-lumma, and it's also called a limma. And the third one is al-jummah. And al-jummah is ma saqata 'ala al-mankibaini. It is what's on the shoulders, where the hair reaches the shoulders, drops on the shoulders. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam's hair was like that. Sometimes it was on his earlobe, sometimes it was slightly less, it was a bit lower than the earlobe, not necessarily reaching the shoulders, which is the lummah. And sometimes it would touch his shoulders, salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi, which is al-jummah. The tenth, inshallah ta'ala, point is in the hadith of al-Baraa ibn Aazib radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, is when al-Baraa ibn Aazib said, alayhi hullatun hamra. Alayhi hullatun hamra. This mentions that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was wearing a red garment. Baraa ibn Aazib is saying the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was wearing hullatun hamra. عليه حلة حمراء ما رأيت شيئا قط أحسن منه. How do you reconcile that with another hadith narrated from Ibn Azib رضي الله تعالى عنه, Al-Baraa ibn Azib? He said, نهانا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet prohibited us from, عن المياثير الحمر, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم prohibited us from wearing red garments. How do you reconcile that with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam here himself wearing a red garment? First of all, the word that's used is al-hullah. And the word al-hullah in the qamus, if you look at the dictionary, it's hullah bidam. So you have to say hullah. Hullah is izarun wa rida. It's when there is a lower garment and an upper garment. That's what a hullah means. And in the Qamus, it says, وَلَا يَكُونُ حُلَّةً إِلَّا مِنْ ثَوْبَيْنِ أَوْ ثَوْبٌ لَهُ بَاطِنَةٌ. It's when there's two garments. And Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah, he mentions it. He says, in Sharh Sahih Muslim, he says, قَالَ أَهْلُ اللُّغَةِ الْحُلَّةُ لَا تَكُونُ إِلَّا ثَوْبَيْنِ وَيَكُونُ غَالِبًا إِزَارًا وَرِدَاءً. That's what it is. It's when it's two garments, lower garment and an upper garment. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was wearing a lower garment and upper garment that was red. And the reason why it's called hullah is because he says, قَالَ أَهْلُ اللُّغَةَ لَا تَكُونُ إِلَّا ثَوْبَيْنِ سُمِّيَتْ بِذَلِكَ لِأَنَّ أَحَدَهُمَا يَحِلُّ عَلَى الْآخَرِ. As Imam al-Nawawi mentioned, the reason is because one garment will go on top of the other one. Okay. The red garment that the Prophet was wearing and the one that he prohibited, how do we reconcile between it? Some scholars like Ibn al-Humam and Ibn al-Qayyim and other great scholars, they've taken the opinion that the garment here that the Prophet was wearing was not only red, there were other colors mixed in it. ولذلك Ibn al-Humam, he says, الْحُلَّةُ الْحَمْرَاءِ عِبَارَةٌ عَنْ ثَوْبَيْنِ مِنَ الْيَمَنِ فِيهَا خُطُوطٌ حُمْرٌ وَخُضْرٌ لِأَنَّهُ لَا أَنَّهُ أَحْمَرٌ بَحْتٌ. He said he was wearing two garments from Yemen. Okay? It had red lines in there. Okay? He said it's not only pure red. It's not only pure red. The same Ibn al-Qayyim says. He says, غَلِظَ مَنْ ظَنَّ أَنَّهَا كَانَتْ حَمْرَاءَ بَحْتًا لَا يُخَالِطُهَا غَيْرُهَا وَإِنَّمَا الْحُلَّةُ الْحَمْرَاءَ بُرْدَانِ يَمَنِيَانِ مَنْسُوجَانِ بِخُطُوطٍ حُمْرٍ مع الأسود كسائر البرود اليمانية وهي معروفة بهذا الاسم باعتبار ما فيها من الخطوط وإنما وقعت شبهة من لفظ الحلة الحمراء انتهى. Ibn al-Qayyim argues and he says it's a mistake on behalf of the people who think that the Prophet was only wearing full red. No, there were other colors mixed with it, like black. And he said this is something that was known already, that the burud al-yamaniya, that's how it is. It's red mixed with black. Okay, that the Prophet was wearing. Muhammad Ali Shawkani, he does not accept that from Ibn al-Qayyim. And he refutes Ibn al-Qayyim on this point. And Imam Shawkani. And he says, the Sahabi clearly said, hullatul hamra. And nowhere did he mention there was other colors mixed to it. And he said that the kalam should be taken upon its haqiqah, not majaz. He goes, he takes that path, Shawkani. And he discusses it deeply. You can find it there. Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani also mentions it. He says, Al-Hadithu Sahihun wa bihi istadalla imamun al-Shafi'i ala hilli lubsi al-Ahmari. And Imam al-Shafi'i used this hadith for the permissibility of wearing red. So ala kulli hal, you're allowed to wear red as long as it's mixed with other colors, inshallah ta'ala. As long as what? Mixed with red colors, with other colors. The 11th point, inshallah ta'ala, that we want to take from the hadith is the statement of al-Baraa ibn Aazibin, where he said, ma ra'aytu shay'an qat, I haven't seen anything ahsana minhu, greater than him. Which is the 11th point. عليه حلة حمراء ما رأيت شيئا قط أحسن منه ما رأيت شيئا. I haven't seen anything. The word شيئا, he means أي من المخلوقات, from the creation of course. Okay, he said ما رأيت شيئا. And by the way, شيئا is a nakira, and there is a نفي here, so it's generalization from all of the creations. By the way, he didn't say ما رأيت إنسانا. Ah, he didn't say that, wallahi. It's a noble companion. Because he wants to bring in there the sun and the moon. He wants to bring them into this hadith. That's why he said, ma ra'aytu shay'an. When he says shay'an, the moon will fall under here. The sun will fall under here. Okay? He's referring to only the makhluqat. Because Allah can be referred to as shay'. Ay na'am. Allah referred to himself as shay' in the Quran. Allah says, قُلْ أَيُّ شَيْءٍ أَكْبَرُ شَهَادًا قُلِ اللَّهِ شَهِيدٌ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَكُمْ وَأُوحِيَ إِلَيَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنُ لِأُنذِرَكُمْ بِهِ وَمَنْ بَلَغَ أَإِنَّكُمْ لَتَشْهَدُونَ أَنَّ مَعَ اللَّهِ آلِهَةً أُخْرَى قُلْ لَا أَشْهَدُ قُلْ إِنَّمَا هُوَ إِلَهٌ وَاحِدٌ وَإِنَّنِي بَرِيءٌ مِمَّا تُشْرِكُونَ وَإِنَّنِي بَرِيءٌ مِمَّا تُشْرِكُونَ. So the beginning of the ayah, Allah says, قُلْ أَيُّ شَيْءٍ أَكْبَرُ شَهَادَةً قُلِ اللَّهِ. Then Allah تبارك وتعالى refers to himself as شيء. But when he said, مَا رَأَيْتُ شَيْئًا, he means أي من المخلوقات, from the creation. He hasn't seen anyone from the creation. And he used the word شَيْئًا here, and not مَا رَأَيْتُ إِنسَانًا لِيُفِيدَ التَّعْمِيمَ, so he can generalize it, حَتَّى يَتَنَاوَلَ الشَّمْسَ وَالْقَمَرَ, so the sun and the moon can fall under that. That even the sun and the moon are not as pretty as the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. And then look what he said, قَطٌ أَحْسَنَ مِنْهُ. The word قَط, there's sab'a lughat in it. I'm not going to go into it. You can find and look for it yourself, inshallah ta'ala. He said, ahsana minhu. When he used the word ahsana minhu, he's negating two things. There's no one better than the Prophet, definitely. When the beauty of the Prophet, he said, I never saw anyone. Ahsana minhu, of course, is negating anyone who's more greater than him. One. He's also negating what? Also, he's negating anyone equal to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is common amongst the Arabs. They say, لَيْسَ فِي الْبَلَدِ أَفْضَلُ مِنْ زَيْدٍ. And they mean by that, أَنَّهُ أَفْضَلُ مِنْ كُلِّ وَاحِدٍ. They mean that he is the best person of in this village, in this town. And this is بِدَلَالَةُ الْعُرْفِ. This is known by way of the custom and the culture of the people. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there's no one like him in beauty, and there's no one better than him. Salawatullahi wasallam alayhi. That's what the Sahabi said. And we're also going to see what Ali ibn Abi Talib also said, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. I'm going to stop there here. I'm going to stop here, inshallah ta'ala. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and Shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are both free from it. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdi, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayhi.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. How can you do a 2-second action right now that will give you a share of the reward of everything we're doing on this YouTube channel? Simple. Like this video and click subscribe. Why? It will allow YouTube to recommend our videos to other users. And imagine the huge amount of reward that could be waiting for you on the Day of Judgment if you did that with a sincere intention of spreading the deen of Allah. You'll be rewarded for every single person who benefits from one of our videos as a result of your like or subscribe. That's an easy 2-second action that you definitely don't want to miss out on. Do it now, click like and subscribe, and don't forget to make that intention.